In the second video on Heidegger's brilliant essay, The Origin of the Work of Art, we're going to pick up where we left off with the last one, which is towards the end of the very first section, before he starts to discuss truth itself. And I'm going to do a little bit of review and talk a bit about where he's going with this. You notice I've got this sort of equation up on the board, which we're going to have to discuss. Then we're going to look at two concepts or notions that Heidegger brings in that the work of art brings home to us as part of its essence in a way that's unprecedented among other types of beings. And that is, on the one hand, world, which is a matter of disclosedness, and then earth, which is a matter of that which cannot by principle be completely disclosed. And these two fit in together, and the work of art ties in with them. And these are all part of what Heidegger would call the being of the kind of being which we human beings are, Dasein. And so this essay is leading us further and further into Heidegger's metaphysics. Then after that, we're going to talk a bit about Heidegger's understanding of truth and how it fits in with the artwork. And if you want to know more about Heidegger on truth itself, I would suggest that you take a look at my video on the essence of truth, where I look at that particular essay of Heidegger, where he's focused almost exclusively on taking us through a sequence that he's going to do in this one, where he starts out with a very superficial understanding of truth as available to us in propositions, as sort of an adequation between a proposition and the states of affairs or conditions of things. And then he goes deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper into finally reaching truth as being Aletheia, and or unveiling, and we finally start to explore what the foundation of truth, the essence of truth is. It turns out that truth is something historical, something human, not something that exists out there by itself, all, you know, on its own, completely independent of human existence, but that we humans have a role in it. And this comes to us, this really comes to a crux in the work of art, because the work of art, interestingly enough, has a primary role in the human being and its relationships with being, capital B, and beings, and the revelation of the truth of those beings. So, but let's pick up where we left off. So, he talks about equipment, and so we need to work our way a little bit back into that. He talks about the predominant thing concept. Why are we talking about things? Well, remember, back when we first started looking at the artwork, we were tempted to sort of leave aside the thingly aspect of the artwork and just focus on what, you know, the upper level, you might say, the, you know, what it is that the artwork is trying to convey to us. He talked about allegory, he talked about symbol. And Heidegger wanted to call our attention to the fact that, no, the thingly aspect really is part of the work of art. It matters. And then we had to think about, well, how do we conceive of things? And he noticed that there were three main conceptions in Western metaphysics by which we tended to think about things, and then we tended to, you might say, superimpose that as a filter onto being and beings in general, and think of the way in which we understood thing as the general type of being. Now, one of these stood out in particular, and we talked a little bit about Aristotle, we talked a little bit about technology in this. And it's formed matter, where you notice I've got form set above matter, because we think of form usually as something that superimposes itself, generally through the agency of some sort of former, onto some material substructure. And the material substructure is inert, passive, it allows the form, it receives the form. As a matter of fact, if you look at, you know, Thomas Aquinas and the notion of prime matter, ultimately you get to almost something like nothingness itself, that is mere potentiality to receive. Heidegger wants to resist this. Why? Is he saying that this doesn't hold for anything? No, there is some type of being for which this formed matter thing makes particularly good sense. That's the kind of being that he calls equipment. And formed matter, at least he's saying in this essay, does reveal to us the essence of equipment. And remember, equipment is there for some sort of use. And the better the equipment is, the less it actually gets in the way of attaining that sort of use. Now, here's where, so far, equations have been holding. Now we want to say, no, this is not equal. And I understand, yes, I should have only put one thing rather than an X, but I wanted to really emphasize this. Is the essence of equipment the same thing as the essence of a thing or the essence of a work, an artwork? Heidegger wants to say no. He thinks there's a fundamental mistake that gets made if we conceive of the artwork, or if we conceive of just bare things themselves, as being types of equipment, as being types of formed matter. And he traces this error back, whether, you know, for better or for worse, we can, you know, decide whether he actually is correct about this or not, to Greek conceptions, and then to a Christian conception of being as created being, and then to the modern conception, which sort of takes God out of the picture and puts nature or something else like that, perhaps man, in its place. But in every case, sees things in terms of formed matter. So we want to get away from that. And he says, the equipmental quality of equipment was discovered. How? Well, through an artwork. We looked at Van Gogh's shoe paintings, and we wanted to see what they actually told us. And he says, the artwork lets us know what shoes are in truth. Truth. So he says, what happens here? What is at work in the art? Van Gogh's painting is the disclosure of what the equipment, the pair of peasant shoes, is in truth. In a certain way, it takes us, even though it's about equipment, it takes us beyond the realm of equipment. And he says, this being emerges into the unconcealment of its being, capital B. Right? The Greeks call this unconcealment of beings Aletheia. We say truth and think little enough of it in using this word. If there occurs in the work a disclosure of a particular being disclosing what and how it is, then there is an occurring, a happening of truth at work. So what's going on in an artwork, as opposed to just, say, looking at a pair of shoes as equipment, is an opening in which truth is coming to light. So he says, in the work of art, the truth of beings has set itself to work. What's really interesting here, and this is something I should say something about from the start, for Heidegger, and this is a very important note about phenomenology and about the kind of phenomenology that Heidegger is carrying out, we often tend to think of things, particularly objects in the world, as purely passive, as the recipients or receivers or the objects for which we are the subject imposing a kind of order, intentionality, pick whatever you like, set of ideas, principles, purposes, projects, use a Heideggerian word. Phenomenology means attentiveness, among other things, attentiveness to the things, seeing what they are, allowing them to reveal themselves. That revealing is not just a projection on our part, not just attentiveness on our part, but an interplay between us and what we can normally consider objects. The water in this is in coffee right now, it's fairly late at night, so it's water. I taste the water, and if we go through just the physiology of it, you know, it affects the nerves within my mouth connected to different organs, including my tongue, my palate, and then that sends signals to my brain. But Heidegger is saying that's not what our ordinary experience reveals to us. Phenomenology is attentive to reality as we experience it. The way in which the scientist might describe it is in many ways abstract and artificial and getting away from what it is that we actually do perceive. I perceive the water as being hot or being cold, as offering me refreshment, as offering me annoyance, as offering me all sorts of things. And the water ceases to become something purely passive in that respect. It gives itself to me. In phenomenology, giving itself es gibt, there is one of the basic conceptions. So Heidegger is talking about, in truth, beings actually giving themselves or revealing themselves to us. So that's something very important. In the artwork, Van Gogh's shoes are not just there for us to extend our, you know, senses out to, they are also interplaying with us. So he says, in the work of art, the truth of beings has set itself to work. To set means here to bring to stand. Some particular being, a pair of peasant shoes, comes in the work to stand in the light of being. Now, this brings us to the question, what happens in an artwork? He talks about the particular being standing in the light of being capital B. We'll get to that in just a moment, because you might say, well, what's the difference between being small B and being capital B? That's what Heidegger calls the ontological difference, by the way. So he also says the being of beings comes into the steadiness of its shining. There's a kind of lapidary sentence right there, which requires some unpacking. The being of beings, being, capital B, undergirds, produces, allows all other being. It is what gives it its capacity to be. And we often tend to mistake being, small b, a particular range of beings, with being the totality of everything, encompassing everything, and that which is the origin of all these things. So he says, the essence of art would then be this, the truth of being setting itself to work. Beings in relation to being. And he says, where we've made our mistakes up until this point is thinking that art has only to do with beauty, aesthetics, that it doesn't have to do with truth, that, you know, we can separate over here is aesthetics and beauty, and the artist who tend to be, you know, kind of, you know, strange types, right, you know, disconnected from our ordinary world, or the world of science, or the world of the mind. And then over here we have the analytic type of person who's concerned with logic and truth and all that. Heidegger is saying, no, there's a continuum here, and these are all connected with each other. So he says, perhaps the proposition that art is setting itself to work intends to revive the obsolete view that art is an imitation depiction of something actual. He wants to disabuse us of this conception as well. Art is not merely mimesis in the sense of reproduction. If it is mimetic, it is mimetic in a more active sense, in a sense which allows something to occur. So he says, the work is not the reproduction of some particular entity that happens to be at hand at any given time. So, you know, I decide I want to do a still life and set up a vase and some flowers over there and maybe, you know, some pens or something, or, you know, some maybe a palette to show that I'm a real artist. And now I just paint that sort of stuff willy-nilly. The principle of selection involved in this, he says, it takes us beyond. The artwork is, on the contrary, the reproduction of the thing's general essence. When you have good art, real art, something more is happening than just mere copying. This is why portraits, good portraits, are so much better than photographs. They reveal to us the character of the person. There could be some concealment in that. There could be some misdirection as well. But we're able to see that person as a person, not merely as an image that represents the person. So he says, but then where and how is this general essence so that artworks are able to agree with us? And he's got this great passage here where he discusses this this Meyer's poem, Roman Fountain. And he said, I'll read it to you. He says, the jet ascends and falling fills the marble basin circling round. This veiling over spills into a second basin's ground. The second in such plenty lives, its bubbling flood a third invests, and it each at once receives and gives and streams and rests. And he says, this is neither a poetic painting of a fountain actually present, nor a reproduction of the general essence of a Roman fountain. Yet, truth is set into the work. What truth is happening in the work? And he asks a question here then. He's asking about happening. Now, this is something worth dwelling on. When we speak of truth happening, we mean that truth actually comes into being in time. That truth is not something, at least in this sense, that is eternal, forevermore. Truth is something that occurs. Truth is something that grows. Truth is something that dwindles. Truth is temporal. He says, can truth happen at all and thus be historical? Historical. Can truth, in its essence, actually be historical? This is a profound thought. So he says, we seek the actuality of the artwork in order to find the art prevailing in it. And it turned out that the thingly substructure was the clue to this. So he says, but to comprehend this thingly feature, the traditional thing concepts are not adequate. This is why we had to get away from this. The preeminence of equipmentality suggested we pose the question of equipment anew while avoiding the current interpretation. So we allowed an artwork to tell us what equipment is. By this means, he says, almost clandestinely, it came to light what is at work in the art. The disclosure of the particular being in its being. In being as such. The happening of truth. So he says, we're now confronted by two corollaries to this. Two points. He says, first, the dominant thing concepts, like formed matter, are inadequate as means of grasping the thingly aspect of the work. Second, what we try to treat as the most immediate actuality of the work, the thingly substructure, does not belong to the work in that way at all. As soon as we start to look for such a substructure in the work, we're treating it like formed matter. We're treating it like equipment, to which we then ascribe a substructure supposed to contain its artistic quality. But that's not what's really going on in a work of art. That might be what's going on in reproduction, you know, a la manière de something. So, you know, when Monet does his water lilies, and if you haven't ever gone to the orangery to experience Monet's water lilies as you know, actual paintings, as opposed to just the prints that we buy in you know, Target or Kmart or things like that, I would strongly advise going there. It's worth going to Paris just to go to l'orangery to see that. There's a lot of things in Paris that you could probably pass over that people think you have to go see. But the water lilies are really worth seeing there. The reproduction of them, or a little portion of the work, doesn't quite have the same truth-conveying capacity as does the work as such, Heidegger would say. So, the work is not a piece of equipment that's fitted out in addition with an aesthetic value. What is going on in the work, then? He says, what matters is first an opening of our vision to the fact that what is workly in the work, equipmental in equipment, and thingly in the thing, comes closer to us only when we think of the being of beings. We have to do metaphysics in order to actually understand types of being, like equipment or work. So he says, we have to drop the barriers of our preconceptions. We have to set aside current pseudo-concepts. So we had to take this detour. This has all been a detour so far, he's saying. Now we're going to get to the real stuff. And he says, but it brings us directly to a road that may lead to a determination of the thingly feature in the work. It should not be denied, but if it belongs admittedly to the work being the work, it must be conceived of not just in terms of thing, but in terms of the work itself. And Heidegger now is going to start paying more attention not to thing or to equipment, but to the artwork and what is going on in the artwork. He says, the artwork opens up in its own way the being of beings. This opening up, this revealing, i.e. the truth of beings, happens in the work. In the artwork, the truth of beings has set itself to work. Art is truth setting itself to work. So what is truth itself that it sometimes appropriates as art? What is this setting forth? Now, before he goes into Aletheia and truth as Aletheia, we have to look at what this setting forth consists in. And that's what we're going to look at next. We are now at what is probably my favorite part of this essay, which is Heidegger's discussion of world and earth in relation to the work of art and the artist. But you notice that the artist is going further and further into the background, you might say actually becoming, as to prefigure a little bit, part of the earth as opposed to being part of the world. Now, he wants us from the beginning to avoid falling into a misconception. There's a lot of sort of disabusing us of misconceptions on Heidegger's part throughout his philosophy, but also in this essay. So he says, we have to try to avoid forcing the work into a preconceived framework by which we obstruct our own access to the work being of the work. Nothing can be discovered about the thingly aspect of the work so long as the pure self-subsistence of the work has not distinctly displayed itself. Works of art are able to stand on their own. That's what he means by self-subsistence, in a certain way. And he starts out by thinking about, you know, how do we make sense of this? Now, think about the way in which we normally portray art. We take the work of art and we set it aside over here in a gallery or an exhibition or in a museum, and usually against a white wall so that, you know, it can stand out and there's nothing distracting us. So he says, to gain access to the work, it would be necessary to remove it from all relations to something other than itself, to allow it to stand on its own. But the artist's most peculiar intention already aims in this direction. Work is to be released by the artist to its pure self-subsistence. When the artist releases the work, and this is an interesting conception of art, it's not about the artist per se. It's not about the artist making a splash or a big name or endorsing their political views or, you know, showing everybody how clever they are by calling something into question. It's about producing art. It's about producing something other than oneself, in which one may be invested, but something other than oneself. So he says, it's precisely in great art, and only such art is under consideration here, that the artist remains inconsequential as compared with the work, almost like a passageway that destroys itself in the creative process for the work to emerge. So how do we encounter the works then? Well, they stand in exhibitions. Or if we want to think about other modes of art, think about music. Is it music best experienced in some sort of context, or do we try to remove it from context or place it in a very specific context, the pageantry of the classical symphony, for example, the rock and roll music show carried out in a concert, which has its own particular aesthetic and ways of doing things to it. Even that might be, you know, what Heidegger is talking about here. The play, do we get it in our Penguin Classic thing with all the footnotes and, you know, commentary? Do we just read the play by itself, unconnected with anything else? Or is it to watch the play in a black box theater? These are all things we ought to think about. So he says, the works themselves stand and hang in collections and exhibitions. They are here in themselves as the works they are, or haven't they become something belonging to the art industry? Haven't they become assimilated into a particular range of activities and beings? So he talks about, you know, the Aegina sculptures in the Munich collection, Sophocles' Antigone in the best critical edition. These are the works, as it were, torn out of their native sphere, torn out of what he calls their world. Now, good works bring a world with them, but Heidegger thinks that some works can lose that capacity over time. He says, even when we make an effort to cancel or avoid such displacement of works, for instance, when we visit the temple in Paestum at its own site or the Bamberg Cathedral on its own square, the world of the work that stands there has perished. So think about the cathedral, for example. I had this experience when I went to Notre Dame. I was very disappointed, as a matter of fact, because, you know, I was very interested in medieval studies at the time, and I still am, but I went in and I had this feeling like, boy, this isn't quite what I'd expected. It's kind of spare, really. Not like the cathedrals I've been to in other places. And it had been turned into, for the most part, it was still a working place, but it, for the most part, a tourist exhibition. So Heidegger says that in that case, the world of the work that stands there has perished. World withdrawal and world decay, he says, can never be undone. I'm not sure about that. He says the works are no longer the works they were. It is them themselves we encounter, but they themselves are gone by. As bygone works, they stand over against us in the realm of tradition and conservation. Tradition and conservation, oddly enough, don't actually end up being conservation of the world that gives the meaning to the work of art, the full meaning. And tradition can become moribund. So he says, they remain merely such objects. Their self-subsistence has fled from them. The whole art industry, even if carried to the extreme and exercised in every way for the sake of works themselves, extends only to the object being of the works. But this does not constitute their work being. What is their work being? What is the work in the art work? So he says, where does a work belong? The work belongs as work uniquely within the realm that is opened up by itself. The realm that is opened up is the world. So he says, we now ask the question of truth with a view to the work. And he says, let's look at an example. Let's use a Greek temple, for example. A building. A Greek temple portrays nothing. It simply stands there in the middle of the rock cliff valley. So what is a temple doing? And we could ask this not about Greek temples, but Aztec temples, Sumerian temples, pick whatever you like. What is the point of a temple? He says the building encloses the figure of the god, and in this concealment lets it stand out into the holy precinct through the open portico. By means of the temple, the god is present in the temple. That doesn't mean that the god is present just as the statue. That means that the god, the divine, pervades the entire structure of the temple. So when you enter and you cross over the threshold, you are passing from a profane into a sacred or holy space. A space in which not only is it understood as being, you know, good or beautiful or something like that, but there is greater being, greater density of being. You're closer towards the reality of things. So he says, it is the temple work that first fits together and at the same time gathers around itself the unity of these paths and relations in which birth and death, disaster and blessing, victory and disgrace, endurance and decline. These are very important pairings. I'm going to go back over this again. Birth and death. Liminal experiences which we see other people undergoing, but we can never actually remember or experience our own in fullness. Disaster and blessing. I'll get to that in a moment. Victory and disgrace. Victory and disgrace. These are aesthetic categories, but we don't usually think of them in terms of aesthetic categories. If we think like ancient Greeks, or we actually think like many other people have through time, we can recognize these as aesthetic categories, as belonging to what the Greeks called the kalon and the aischron. The fine or noble and the shameful or ugly or base. Endurance and decline. These acquire the shape of destiny for human being. The all-governing expanse of this open relational context is the world of this historical people. So the Greek temple makes sense for the Greeks that are practicing there. We can't fully get at what was there for them. So he says, standing there, the building rests on the rocky ground. This resting of the work draws up out of the rock the obscurity of that rock's bulky yet spontaneous support. It changes the rock into something else. Standing there, the building holds its ground against the storm raging above it and so makes the storm itself manifest in its violence. Notice what's going on here as this description follows through. The being of beings, what it is and how they are, is allowed to fully come into prominence by this temple being there. The luster and gleam of the stone, though itself apparently glowing only by the grace of the sun, first brings to radiance the light of the day, the breath of the sky, the darkness of the night. The temple's firm towering makes visible the invisible space of air. The steadfastness of the work contrasts with the surge of surf. and its own repose brings out the raging of the sea. Tree and grass, eagle and bull, snake and cricket first enter into their distinctive shapes and thus come to appear as what they are. Now, does that mean that, you know, they didn't exist before that? No. But the temple as work of art allows things to actually come into prominence for the first time as what they are. It makes the world anew. The world is experienced differently, more richly, more distinctly, more articulately, once the temple is in place. So the Greeks early called this emerging and rising in itself and in all things phusis. We translate that as nature. It illuminates also that on which and in which man bases his dwelling. We call this ground the earth. So now we have these two categories, world and earth. So he says, earth occurs essentially as the sheltering agent. World and earth are both encompassing, but in very different ways. So he says, the temple work, standing there, opens up a world, and at the same time sets this world back again on earth, which itself only thus emerges as native ground. The background can only be the background once you actually have something in the foreground, and the temple itself is calling attention to all these things in the foreground that now attain a greater prominence over and against the sheltering background of the earth. So he says, men and animals, plants and things are never present and familiar as unchangeable objects, only to represent incidentally also a fitting environment for the temple, which one fine day is added to what is already there. We'll get closer if we look at things in reverse order, he says. So let's look at that. The temple, in its standing there, first gives to things their look. And this is even more important. So it gives to things their look. It allows us to see things in the world as what they are. And it also allows the human being, there's a cycloidal kind of thing, to, for the first time, really reflect upon itself. It gives to men their outlook on themselves. It says this: the view remains open as long as the work is a work, as long as the god has not fled from it. It is the same with the sculpture of the god, the votive offering of the victor in the Olympic Games, or a portrait. Same thing holds for the linguistic work. In the tragedy, nothing is staged or displayed theatrically. The linguistic work originating in the speech of the people does not refer to the battle of the old gods against the new gods. It transforms the people's saying so that now every living word fights this battle. In what then does the work being of the work consist? It says, keeping steadily in view the points just indicated, two essential features of the work may be brought out more distinctly. So he says, a work sets up a world. Setting up no longer means a bare placing. Setting up means something like consecrating. And this category, or distinction of blessing and curse, dedication, consecration, praise, all of these are particularly important for what Heidegger is talking about. He says to dedicate means to consecrate, in the sense that in setting up the work, the holy is opened up as holy, and the god is invoked into the openness of his presence. Praise belongs to dedication as doing honor to the dignity and splendor of the god. So praise and blame as well, because there's also, you know, blaming or criticizing or vituperating. These are basic fundamental human categories. I'm going to talk about Aristotle and Plato in just a moment and how these categories fit in. It says, dignity and splendor are not properties beside and behind which the god stands as something distinct. It's in the godhead itself. In the reflected glory of this splendor, there glows, there clarifies what we call the world. When we have a world, we don't just first have a bunch of different objects, which then we subjectively impose project a whole bunch of moral categories onto. That is actually part of the world. Now, that can also become a lure and a trap and all that sort of stuff. Heidegger talks about that in Being and Time. But here, he's much more optimistic about this. Now, I want to make a short little digression here. Plato and Aristotle, in their works, they're not the only people to do this, but they set out a number of different oppositions, categories, that correspond to what we would call broadly speaking, moral categories. In the Euthyphro and in the Credo, and also in the Republic, Plato does this explicitly. He talks about things like the good and the bad, the just and the unjust, the noble and the base. These are the things that people argue about and get angry about and disagree with about when we come to blows and argument. The gods themselves argue about these and don't fully agree about these. Aristotle adds to these things in the rhetoric and in the ethics and the politics categories like the useful and the harmful, the painful and the pleasurable. These are all ways. Aristotle also talks about us perceiving these, not just inferring these, not just talking about these, but he uses the word aisthai, which is the word for sense perception or perception in some other way. These are things, he says in Politics Book 1, which we, unlike the other animals, fully perceive. And that's why we can talk about them, and that's why we can argue about them, and that's why we can have sharing, koinonia, in them. And that's why we can have discord about them, and we can progressively discover and uncover them. So a world already includes these things, and one of the key categories is praise and blame. Praise and blame, Aristotle says, is particularly appropriate, and this is in the rhetoric, to epideictic rhetoric, which has to do with the noble, the kalon, and the base, or the beautiful and the ugly, the aistron. Heidegger is playing off of all of this. All of those categories are there in the world of the artwork. So, says, why is the setting up of a work and erecting that consecrates and praise? Because the work in its work being demands it. This is of the essence of real artwork, of real, what we might say, cultural work, going, you know, beyond just mere fine arts or something like that. It says, towering up within itself, the world opens up a world and keeps it abidingly in force. So the world the work brings its own world with it. That's part of the production of the work. So it says, to be a work means to set up a world. What is it to be a world? Now, here Heidegger once again wants to make sure that we don't fall into some basic category mistakes. The world is not something that you can experience by tallying up and totaling up and enumerating all of the objects within the world and their relations, as some philosophers might want to do. The world goes beyond that. It is encompassing. It brings with it the orderings, the disorderings, all of that sort of stuff. He says the world whirls. The world is active, right? It imposes itself on us. We are within the world. The world is not just merely a product of us. The world whirls and is more fully in being than the tangible and perceptible realm in which we believe ourselves to be at home. We perceive this amount here, and the world exceeds that. It goes beyond that. And it is a realm of intelligibility and openness. So he says, it is the ever non-objective to which we are subject as long as the pangs of birth and death, blessing and curse, once again, blessing and curse, keep us transported into being. Whenever those utterly essential decisions of our history are made, we are taken up and abandoned by us, go unrecognized, and are rediscovered by new inquiry. There the world worlds. A stone by itself is worldless. This piece of chalk is worldless. Plants and animals by themselves have no world, but they belong to the covert throng of a surrounding into which they're linked. The peasant woman, on the other hand, has a world, because she dwells in the overtness of beings. Every human being, every Dasein, by virtue of being a human being, dwells in a world. The work of art can bring this into greater prominence, can make the world shine forth as what it is. So he says a work, by being a work, makes space for that spaciousness. The work holds open the open region of the world. But the setting up of a world is only the first essential feature. What is the other essential feature? He says, when a work is created, brought forth out of this or that work material, we say that it is made, set forth out of it. But just as the work requires a setting up, also a setting forth is needed. What is the setting forth? There, we turn to Earth. So he says, let's think about equipment again and matter. In fabricating equipment, stone is used and used up. It disappears into usefulness. By contrast, the temple work in setting up a world, it does not cause the material to disappear, but rather causes it to come forth for the very first time and to come into the open region of the world's works world. The rock comes to bear and to rest and so first becomes rock. It finally gives itself to us as rock. We say, ah, now I know what rock really is in its heart. Metals come to glimmer and shimmer, colors to glow, tones to sing, the word to say. And here, you know, it's worth thinking about the difference between poetry that moves us, or oratory that moves us, and mere utilitarian use of language. When we're just using the words to try to get something across, you know, writing a report, for example, if the words don't get in the way, that's the best. But when we're reading poetry, we're not just trying to get past the words to some sense that's beyond them. We're trying to linger in the words. We're trying to actually see for the first time what dog means, what and means, what temple means. And we do that within the context of a linguistic world and work. So he says, that into which the work sets itself back and which causes it to come forth is what we call the earth. Earth is that which comes forth and shelters, it sustains. He says, upon the earth and in it, historical man grounds his dwelling in the world. In setting up a world, the work sets forth the earth. So setting up, setting forth. This setting forth must be thought here in the strict sense of the word. The work moves the earth itself. Here's where it gets really interesting. The work moves the earth itself, which is there already, into the open region of the world. Eventually, this is going to lead to what we call the rift, but I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit. The earth is already there. The earth comes into prominence as what is always lying beneath, just beneath the world. So he says, the earth appears openly cleared as itself only when it is perceived and preserved as that which is essentially undisclosable. There is always a mysteriousness, I don't quite have it, I can't quite get my mind around it, to the earth. That which shrinks from every disclosure and constantly keeps itself closed up. And he says, now this is not some sort of, you know, abstract category out there like the other in continental philosophy or the unthinkable or anything like that. As a matter of fact, it shows up in myriad ways. He says, this setting forth of the earth is achieved by the work as it sets itself back into the earth. The self-seclusion of earth is not a uniform, inflexible, staying undercover, but unfolds itself in an inexhaustible variety of simple modes and shapes. So the woodness of the wood contains something of the earth and is sheltered by the earth, and I don't fully know what wood is, or this wood, or ash, or oak, or charcoal, for that matter, or fire. There always remains something that is right there in front of us, but we don't fully get. And if we did fully get it, the world and the earth and the artwork would actually fall apart into meaninglessness. This is part of what we need. So he says, nowhere in the work is there any trace of a work material? It even remains doubtful whether in the essential definition of equipment, what the equipment consists of is properly described in its equipmental essence of matter. The painter uses pigment, but in such a way that color is not used up, but rather only now comes to shine forth. That's what's made possible because of having earth and world. So he says, in the essential features just mentioned, if our account has any validity at all, we've indicated in the work rather a happening and no sense a repose. So now we're moving to another thing. Rest is in fact, he says, a type of motion, not just the opposite of motion. And what is the motion that's taking place within the work? He says, well, let's think about the world and about the earth. The world is the self-opening openness of the broad paths of the simple and essential decisions and the destiny of the historical people. Now notice, It's not just a bunch of objects. It's not just a surrounding environment. It's not just affectively cathected with all these moral qualities. It reflects a history. It reflects a narrative. It reflects decisions that have been made. The earth is the spontaneous forthcoming of that which is continually self-secluding and to that extent sheltering and concealing. He says, world and earth are essentially different from one another and yet are never separated. You can't have one without the other. And they don't exist in a pure sort of harmonious relationship with each other either. He says, the relationship between the world and earth does not wither away into the empty unity of opposites. The world, in resting upon the earth, strives to surmount it, tries to bring everything into intelligibility. As self-opening, it cannot endure anything closed. The earth, however, is sheltering and concealing, tends always to draw the world into itself, back into itself, and keep it there. So, what is this opposition at its heart, then? It is what Heidegger calls strife, contestation. He says, in essential strife, what happens? The opponents raise each other into the self-assertion of their essential natures. They can only be what they are through this strife with each other. Self-assertion of essence is not a rigid insistence upon some contingent strait, but surrender to the concealed originality of the provenance of one's own being. World discovers what it is, unveils what it is in relation to its strife with earth. Earth, in coming forth, in resisting, in absorbing again, shows what it really is as well. And it does this not just globally, but locally. So he says, in strife, each opponent carries the other beyond itself. Thus, the strife becomes ever more intense as striving and more properly to what is. The earth cannot dispense with the open region of the world if it itself is to appear as earth. They both need each other. The world, in turn, cannot soar out of the earth's sight unless it is grounded on something decisive. So, where does the work come in? He says, in setting up a world and setting forth the earth, the work is the instigating of this strife. This does not happen so that the work should at the same time settle and put an end to strife, but so that the strife may remain a strife. Setting up a world and setting forth the earth, the work accomplishes this strife. The strife arrives at its high point in the simplicity of intimacy, that the unity of the work comes about in the instigation of strife. And what happens there? There's intimacy created. There is a mutual relation between world and earth that's ever shifting, ever changing, but has essential features. So, what's going on? He says, from the repose of the work, we can now see what is at work in the work. Until now, it was merely a provisional assertion that in an artwork, truth is set to work. Now we can actually begin to talk about the truth, the unveiling in the work. We're now posed with an essential question, which is a question about essence, if we want to turn it on its head. What is truth? Heidegger says, again, up until this point, we've been kind of moving in bit by bit by bit, stripping away prejudices, stripping away preconceptions, and he says, until now it was merely provisional assertion that in an artwork truth is set to work. In what way does truth happen in the work being of the work, which now means to say, how does truth happen in the instigation of strife between world and earth? What is truth? So, you'll notice that in this section, he is going to run through a bunch of different notions of truth, and he's not going to say that any of these are completely wrong, but some of these are more superficial than others. And the ones that are superficial are the ones that we tend to begin with. Now again, if you want a fuller, more in-depth discussion of this, I suggest that you take a look at my video on Heidegger on the essence of truth, a very important work where he's devoting his full attention to this question of truth and going through a lot of examples and possible instances of this. So, he says, a cognition articulated in a proposition can be of this sort, propositional. we think of our thought, we think of our language as being true when it conforms to what is, when it has correctness, when it is framed the right way in relation to other things. And he says, we not only call a proposition true, but also things. So now we're starting to get a little bit deeper, right? Then we're talking about actuality. He uses this example that he's used in The Essence of Truth. True gold in contrast with sham gold. True means genuine, actual gold. What does the expression actual mean here? To us, it is what is in truth. The true corresponds to the actual, and the actual is what in truth. And now we have a circle. And here's the problem that Heidegger is gesturing at. And again, discussing more, you know, in greater depth in On the Essence of Truth. Propositional truth, understanding truth as you know, something verbal, something mental, or truth understood in terms of the actuality of the things, it ends up being somewhat circular. We end up having to define truth in terms of itself in order to do that. Ultimately, we want to base truth on a deeper conception of truth that is going to ground those of Aletheia. So he says, what does in truth mean? Truth is the essence of what is true. Now, we're not just talking about truth here and here and here and here. We're trying to say what is the essence? What actually binds all of these truths together? So he makes a distinction here between an unessential essence and what something is in truth. So he says, the essence is discovered in the generic and universal concept which represents the one feature that holds indifferently for many things. This is a conception of essence which is not the one that Heidegger wants to work with. He calls this an indifferent essence, essentiality in the sense of essentia, the unessential essence. So he's understanding essence in a different way here, as I pointed out in other videos, than other people might, where an essence corresponds to a definition that only includes those things and includes all of the things that fit under it and somehow expresses what it is that all of them have in common. So he says, what is the essential essence of something consistent? What is the essential essence? Presumably, it lies in what the entity is in truth. The true essence of a thing is determined by way of its true being, by way of the truth of the given being. Now we're seeking out not the truth of essence, but the essence of truth. So he says, there appears a curious tangle. Is it only a curiosity, or even merely the empty sophistry of a conceptual game? Or is it an abyss? Is the ground falling out from us as we're thinking our way through this? So he says, let's start again. True means the essence of the true. We think this essence in recollecting the Greek word aletheia, unconcealment of beings, coming from lanthanein, meaning to conceal, a is the privative, so aletheia means to unconceal, to reveal, to unveil, to take away what's hiding, what's dissembling, what's rejecting, what is covering up. So he says, is this enough to define the essence of truth? Are we not passing off a mere change of word usage? This is a legitimate criticism, like it's made of Heidegger sometimes. Unconcealment instead of truth is characterization of the matter at issue. And now he goes on a little discursus through the history of Western philosophy, and he says, does this require a revival of Greek philosophy? No. Why not? Well, because the Greeks didn't actually think through Aletheia. They, instead, he's thinking of Plato and Aristotle and the Stoics and going all the way through, tended to focus instead on this more superficial level of propositional truth, or the truth in terms of actuality, truth in terms of correctness, truth in terms of conformity. And he says, the hidden history of Greek philosophy consists from its beginning in this. It does not remain in conformity with the essence of truth that flashes out in the word aletheia, and it has to misdirect its knowing and its speaking about the essence of truth more and more into the discussion of a derivative essence of truth. Another way of saying superficial is saying derivative. These are not invalid. These are not nothing, but they're derivative, according to Heidegger. So the essence of truth as aletheia was not thought out in the thinking of the Greeks and not in the philosophy that followed it. Unconcealment is, for thought, the most concealed thing in Greek existence. And then he says, but why shouldn't we be satisfied with that? If that's where Western philosophy went, so much the better for it. He says, truth means today and has long meant the conformity of knowledge with the matter. Adequatio, you know, intellectum ad res, or, you know, whatever you want. Ad rem, actually, it should be. But he says, the matter must show itself to be such if knowledge and the proposition that forms and expresses knowledge are able to be to conform to it. Otherwise, the matter cannot be binding on the proposition. But how can the matter show itself if it cannot stand forth out of concealment? So unconcealment is a deeper level of truth that is prepropositional in certain respects and has to be going on in order for this other level, which is easier for us to handle and is more familiar to us, to be usable to us. So he says, if here and elsewhere we conceal of truth is unconcealment, we're not merely taking refuge in a more literal translation of Greek word. We're reminding ourselves, this is a very important point Heidegger is making, we're reminding ourselves of what unexperienced and unthought underlies our familiar and therefore outworn essence of truth in the sense of correctness. So he says, as long as we start talking this way, we have to start, you know, digging deeper into this, and we have to start experiencing truth. We have to start paying attention to what's going on when we're actually engaging with truth. So he says, it's not we who presuppose the unconcealment of beings. This isn't just some postulate that Heidegger is throwing out there. Again, he's doing a phenomenological analysis. He says, the unconcealment of beings puts us in such a condition of being that in our representation we always remain installed within and in attendance upon unconcealment. If we rigorously analyze what's going on when we understand things to be true, when we grasp them in truth, this is what we find. So he says, the entire realm in which this conforming to something goes on must already occur as a whole in the unconcealed. And this holds equally of that for which the conformity of a proposition to a matter becomes manifest. So if we want to think about the traditional conception of truth as an adequation or correctness or conformity between mind or language and things of the world, in order for any of this to work, something has to be unconcealed. Something has to show itself. Something has to give itself. That's what he's taking as more fundamental. So, this brings up another question then. How does this take place? How does truth happen in this unconcealment? He says, first, before we do that, we have to say what unconcealment is. So, things are, and human beings, gifts and sacrifices are, plants are, equipment and works are, the particular being stands in being with a capital B. Through being passes a veiled fatality that is ordained between the godly and counter-godly. There's much in being man cannot master. There is but little that comes to be known. What is known remains inexact. What is mastered insecure. Beings are never of our making. They confront us, you might say. He's not saying that here, but they confront us. Beings are never of our making or even merely our representations. When we contemplate this whole as a one, then we apprehend all that is, though we grasp it crudely enough. And yet beyond beings, there is still something else that happens. In the midst of beings as a whole, an open place occurs. There is a clearing, he says. Thought of in reference to being, this clearing is more in being than our beings. It is, in some sense, more real, more fundamental. It has greater ontological density, to use a word that I particularly like. Not a Heideggerian word, it's one that I particularly like to use. This has more reality than the beings themselves. This open center is not surrounded by beings. The clearing center encircles all that is, as does the nothing. And again, if you want to know more about the nothing, then we want to look at Heidegger's What is Metaphysics, and I've got a video on that if you want to see that. So he says, beings can be as beings only if they stand within and stand out within what is cleared in this clearing. When we actually grasp something as something, it's because out of the entire blah, you know, craziness, flood of experience, we're parsing some things out. We're clearing some things. And we do this not just individually by ourselves, we do this in conjunction with other beings, other human beings, and even other animal beings, and being telling us how we ought to perceive it. So he says, only this clearing grants and guarantees to us humans a passage to those beings that we ourselves are not. So the relationship between subject and object is coming through this clearing. And you notice that I've got Dasein here. That's the kind of being that we are, according to Heidegger. Being there. We have our relation to beings in this clearing, and also through them and through the clearing to ourself. We're the being that is able to be concerned with its own being. So he says, this grants and guarantees to us humans a passage to those beings that we ourselves are not, and access to the being that we ourselves are. You can't have something like Cartesian self-knowledge for Heidegger in total isolation from everything else. I'm going to go and just think and abstract away from everything. We have to know ourselves through the experience of being in relation to beings and it being in this clearing. And that also means in relation to other Daseins as well, although he doesn't talk about that here. So he says, thanks to the clearing, beings are unconcealed in certain changing degrees. So that's taken us to a point now. Now we're going to sort of shift gears. If there's unconcealment, that means that there's also concealment. So is there concealment also in the clearing? And the answer is yes. And this is also going to mean that there is untruth, or the opposite of truth, within truth. Sounds very paradoxical, but is really central to Heidegger's view of things. So he says, a being can be concealed only within the realm of what is cleared. We have to actually perceive something as something before we can be puzzled by it, before we can have it deny itself to us, before it can fight against us, you might say. And he goes into a very brief examination of what modes there are of concealment. And he says, beings refuse themselves to us down to that one and seemingly least feature which we touch upon most readily when we can say no more of beings that they are. Concealment as refusal, when beings refuse themselves to us, is not simply and only the limit of knowledge, but the beginning of the clearing of what is cleared. It's at the very edge of the clearing, so to speak. But concealment, at the same time, also occurs within what is cleared. One being places itself in front of another being. Beings conceal each other. The one helps to hide the other. The former obscures the latter. A few obstruct many, one denies all. This is part of what is going on, to go back a ways, when Heidegger is talking about our preconceptions of being that we project onto all of being, say, you know, treating everything as equipment, we effectively participate in a concealment of the nature of beings by treating them merely as formed matter, or pick whatever else you like. So he says, there's also another mode, though. So it's not just concealment. There's also, or refusal, there's also dissembling. A being appears, so it's not hidden behind another being, but it presents itself as other than it is. So he said, if one being did not simulate another, we could not make mistakes or act mistakenly in regard to beings. We could not go astray, we could not transgress, and we could not overreach ourselves. That a being should be able to deceive his semblance is the condition for our being able to be deceived. We are able to be deceived by beings, and also by our own being, because that's part of the nature of beings. That is a possibility inherent within every single being. It can be taken the wrong way. It can be understood as something other than what it is. So he says, concealment can be refusal or merely dissembling. We're never fully certain which it is. Concealment conceals and dissembles itself. So we have this clearing, this openness, this unconcealment, within which we discover beings. And those beings don't give themselves entirely to us in a perfect lucidity or illumination or intelligibility. There's also, even our own being, there's also concealment going on at the same time. And there's concealment of concealment. This might remind you, if we wanted to go off on a digression, of the Freudian discussion of repression, of the fact of repression. This is very important stuff that we're getting at here. Something similar happens with respect to moral philosophy in terms of vice. The vicious person does not actually realize themselves as vicious, and they conceal from themselves the fact that they're vicious, and they think that they are something other than they are. Generally, they believe themselves virtuous, and they believe other beings to be vicious. So he says, clearing occurs only as this double concealment. The unconcealment of beings, it's never a merely existent state, but a happening. It's in transit. It's in flux. It occurs. It's ongoing. It is something that Heidegger doesn't talk about this, but we could think about this. You could have a narrative of it. It is something that can be built upon. It is something that you could proceed through steps. So he says, we believe we're at home in the immediate circle of beings. Beings are familiar, reliable, ordinary. But the ordinary is completely extraordinary, according to Heidegger. The clearing is pervaded by a constant concealment in the double form of refusal and dissembling. At bottom, the ordinary is not ordinary. It is dominated throughout by a denial. When we stick with just the merely ordinary and we're not surprised by, we're not in awe, we're not experiencing the multiplicity, the ambiguity of being and beings, we're actually hiding being from ourselves. So he says, this is what's occurring, truth, in the concealing denial. It provides the steady provenance of all clearing, and yet meets out to all clearing the indefeasible severity of error. Concealing denial is intended to denote that opposition in the very essence of truth. So how does this get us back now to world and to earth and to the artwork? He says, the essence of truth is in itself the primal strife in which the open center, the clearing, is one within which beings stand and from which they set themselves back into themselves. This open region is what? The world, right? The world is the clearing of the paths of the essential guiding directions with which all decision complies. Our decisions that we make, going this way, we follow those out into the clearing. We extend the clearing by doing that. And at the same time, every decision bases itself on something not mastered, something concealed, confusing. Otherwise, it would never be a decision. Every decision not only extends world, it also rests upon the earth that's in strife with world. Something, it brings in more concealment. If we knew everything perfectly, we would never actually decide in any real sense. We would just simply go that way. Decision, human decision, something that is proper to Dasein, to human being, requires that we don't have complete illumination. Brilliant, beautiful thought. I wish he would have worked this out further, but he doesn't here. He does in other places. So he says, the earth is not simply the closed region, but rather that which rises up as self-closing. World and earth are always intrinsically and essentially in conflict, belligerent by nature. Only as such do they enter into the strife of clearing and concealing. Earth juts through the world. This is a beautiful metaphor. Earth juts through the world, and the world grounds itself on the earth only so far as truth happens as the primal strife between clearing and concealing. So this entire strife, conflict, productive, whatever you want to call it, between world and earth, is actually resting on, or can be characterized as, the play of concealment and unconcealment in relation to each other. How does this happen, he says? It happens in a few essential ways. One of these ways in which truth happens is the work being of the work. setting up a world and setting forth the earth, the work is the instigation of the strife in which the unconcealment of beings as a whole or truth is one. So he uses the temple as an example, but we could use many other examples. What's happening in the work of art, with genuine art, is the clearing is being worked out, is being set up, world is being set up in a way that is in some ways transcendent, is greater than what we would ordinarily have. Like he says, truth happens in Van Gogh's painting. This does not mean that something at hand is correctly portrayed, but rather in the revelation of the equipmental being of the shoes, beings as a whole, world and earth in their counterplay, attain to unconcealment. Thus in the work it is truth, not merely something true. Truth, not merely something true, that is at work. And here he says something very interesting that I'm going to close with, so that we can go into the next material in the next video. He says, the more simply and essentially the shoes are engrossed in their essence, the more directly and engagingly do all beings attain a greater degree of being with them. Now, this is very Neoplatonic language here, where there's greater degrees and lesser degrees of being. Something can have more or less being. And I find this sort of view very, very attractive. I think it fits in well with this as well. Here's what I'm going to close with. We come finally now to talking about beauty. He says, that is how self-concealing being is cleared. Light of this kind joins its shining to and into the work. This shining joined in the work is the beautiful. So the category of the beautiful does come back in here. Beauty is one way in which truth essentially occurs as unconcealment. Now, what does that mean? That means that we can never have rules for beauty, because that would be in the realm of this, wouldn't it? Beauty is something that is going to happen. We can describe it. We can articulate it. We can actually even produce it. We can learn skills for making that happen and for recognizing it when it occurs. But it's always going to be, to some degree, and I hate to use the word contingent here, let's call it fatefully contingent, to take a word from Oda McCard, meaning that something essential is going on, something historical is going on, and we're privileged to be part of it. That's where I'll leave off, and we'll talk more, we'll finish this section, and then go through the rest of the work in the next video.